Chairman, I, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and Symbosis Law School, Pune, welcome you all to another session, which, according to us, has, as a student of law, those who are into teaching faculties in the corporate sectors as well as the lawyers. It's a growing field, but at the same time, it's challenging. And what is the effect of the COVID-19, etc.? We thought that we should ask an expert who can give the insights of the Real Estate Regulatory Act, most popularly called as RERA. Since it's a vast topic, we will not take much time, except for the fact that we will just give two-line introduction that Mr. M.S. Krishnan is a senior advocate in the Madras High Court, and fortuitously, we are enamored by the fact that at the infancy stage of this organization of that is Beyond Law CLC, we had Anirudh Krishnan coming on the topic. That was well received, and that is why they said that the roots got more stronger. We thought that once the son is so good, why not call for the father also, who is such a reputed one. As they say in English, like father, like son, and Hindi also they say like father or like son. So once the son is so like, so we all know that the father, obviously, but we will have much better insights. I'm not saying in any way that Anirudh Krishnan's insights given on that talk, that's well received. The YouTube is a testimony of that. So over to you. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invite.
Thank you. Thank you, Chatrath.
So I think the camera slightly, you will have to adjust it because only your face.
As I told you, I'm
little. No, you told me I'm more because you said Anirudh is nowadays in Bangalore.
Yeah, is okay now? Is
yeah, now it's perfect. Now it's perfect.
At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers of this webinar for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts on RERA.
Just a minute, because SLS has written that she can't hear you. I will ask the other participants.
Yeah.
So just two lines of the test one. Could you just post what Mr. Krishnan is speaking? Are you able to hear him? Just post it on the chat box. Yes, the two lines from your side. So Deepta, you will have to check it at your end because everyone is saying that he's audible. So you can start.
Now, RERA is an act which has been now specifically enforced for the development and regulation of real estate business. Effectively, if you see earlier days in the early 1970s and 80s, it was more of individual houses, owners constructing their own houses through contractors, etc. Then came a phase in the 1980s when apartments became very popular. It means people, outsiders, third parties joining together and buying apartments in a residential complex or a commercial complex where they could all share the common facilities. So this concept really developed in the 80s and 90s, and more due to urbanization, people started moving from the rural areas to cities and towns, which saw a mushrooming of these residential complexes and multi-purpose buildings, etc. So therefore, it is consequent to this, litigation also started. There were some unscrupulous builders who used to take advantage of these innocent buyers. There was always a case of, you know, they were violating norms, the rules, regulations. I can even give you a few examples of what are all the violations on the other activities of builders, which would deprive the home buyers of their legitimate rights. For example, they would have a floor space index, as all of you would have heard, which is the extent of built-up area which can be built up on a particular extent of land. It will be normally 1.5% or 2% depending upon the rule, local rule by the state government or by the competent authority or town and country planning authority. Now, all these problems, say setback violation, normally all of you know that there must be a minimum setback both in the front, rear, and on the sides for any kind of a building. So they always used to cut down on the setbacks so that they'll get more space to build. So I'm not going to elaborate on the various malpractices involved. I'm not trying to say that all builders are like that. But during the 80s and 90s, when the concept was new, this became the order of the day. So therefore, again, what they would do is, if suppose they are entitled to build 10 flats, they will build 10 flats, sell only 8 undivided shares. They will retain 2, so that in the event of competent authority increasing the floor space index, they will then add 2 more flats for themselves. So these were all unethical things, and there was no transparency at all those days. We were not even sure whether a plan that was produced as a sanctioned plan was really a genuine one. In fact, as a lawyer practicing on the civil side and on the real estate, I have seen so many fabricated sanctioned plans being produced. And when you are doing a legal scrutiny, it has to be very, very, you will have to be very, very careful to find out whether the plan sanctions are genuine, and then compare the plan with what has actually been built. Therefore, at some point of time, what were the remedies available to home buyers at that point of time? All of you know, under Section 9 of the Civil Procedure Code, your primary remedy is to approach a civil court. And again, all of us know how ineffective and inefficacious it was. So in the 1980s, they introduced the Consumer Protection Act in the year 1986. Consumer Protection Act was an enactment which provided a remedy for consumers of both goods and services. So building or a housing was also part of a service, but it was only one among, for example, medical negligence also came within the consumer forum disputes. So therefore, the attention to disputes pertaining to real estate really did not take off even in the consumer court. So therefore, it ultimately resulted in accumulation of cases both in the civil courts as well as in the consumer courts, and a home buyer whose only dream was to own a house really came a cropper in all this. So therefore it is, at some point of time, the legislature thought of introducing RERA. Fundamentally, the very object of RERA, if you go by the book, is only to ensure transparency in the dealings when it comes to real estate and construction of apartments and commercial buildings, etc. And development and regulation, that again was important. Now, keeping in mind this, it is actually, according to me, a very comprehensive act which covers every area of real estate. Now, let me go straight, because I have only 45 minutes. There are some legal principles. Now, the objects were to control sale of plots, apartments, buildings, or a real estate project in an efficient and transparent manner to protect the interest of consumers in real estate. And this also provided for the RERA, as it is called. It was constituted under section, the RERA was constituted primarily to perform 3 kinds of functions. One was administrative, 2, advisory to the government on issues pertaining to real estate, 3, an adjudicatory mechanism for resolving the disputes between allottees, promoters, and real estate agents. Now, all the 3, in fact, interestingly, if you will see the provisions, you will find that all the 3 functions are performed by RERA, and there is also an appellate authority. I'll come to it a little later. Now, this act was challenged in the Bombay High Court in Neel Kamal Realtors case, a division bench of the Bombay High Court. The 2 main grounds were the enactment also had penal provisions, and therefore it can't be retrospective. And one of the very main contentions was that the act does not give any relief or remedy to the promoter, and it is one-sided. The Bombay High Court ultimately upheld the act, saying that the promoter also has an equal remedy available before RERA and the appellate authority, and therefore the act is very much constitutional. There is also another Bombay High Court judgment, Lavasa Corporation versus Jitendra Jagdish Tulsiyan, which considers all the provisions of the RERA. So therefore, the RERA has now been upheld, and all the states have set up the mechanism which was conceived under the Act, setting up of RERA, setting up of an appellate authority, etc., etc. Now, let us go to the provisions straight away. The most important section, according to me, is Section 3. Section 3 makes it mandatory for any promoter to register his project with the RERA. So therefore, without a real estate project being registered with RERA, he cannot either advertise, promote, or even receive any money, enter into agreements with prospective purchasers. The entire scenario is meant to bring the promoter into the net of the enactment. Now, how did they, under Section 3 covers what a real estate project is. A real estate project is defined as the development of a building or a building consisting of apartments, converting an existing building or a part thereof into apartments. 3, the development of land into plots or apartments, as the case may be. So therefore, they have literally covered every, either it could be an individual building, or it could be a residential complex, or it could be a promotion of a layout, just the land alone, or promotion of a layout coupled with buildings. So all the activities of real estate have been actually brought into Section 3. And such development should be in a planning area. Planning area is defined as a planning area, or a development area, local planning area, regional development plan area, or whatever name you want. For example, all the states have individual town and country planning acts. So the nomenclature may differ. The center has done legislature has done a very good job of defining it loosely, so that every kind of an activity will fall within the definition of a planning area and a real estate project. Now, what are all the projects that will not come within the scope of Section 3? That if you take Section 3, in fact, I should have asked all of you to have a... See, any land that is proposed to be developed, if it does not exceed 500 square meters, or the number of apartments proposed is will not exceed 8, then such a project will not fall within the net of Section 3 or RERA. Likewise, it also, if some, the state government has also got the power to even reduce it below that threshold by way of an appropriate amendment, then where the promoter has received the completion certificate for a real estate project. Now, in each state, for example, even in Tamil Nadu, I can give you an example. In Chennai, there is the competent authority is Chennai Metropolitan Development Authority, CMDA as we call it. They are the ones who control the planning, sanction is given by them, implementation is also done by them. But in the districts of Tamil Nadu, CMDA has no jurisdiction. There, the Town and Country Planning Authority will be the head, and each municipal corporation or a town panchayat or municipality will ultimately control the sanctioning of plans, etc. So therefore, each state has its own way of Town and Country Planning Act, and the provisions are different. So therefore, the act is general and practically covers every state, the rules in every state as conceived of. Then the other exemption is if a completion certificate is given once a building is totally completed and is in accordance with the plan and rules. Normally, the authority will not give a completion certificate unless and until the construction is in accordance with the sanctioned plan. Now, they have also brought in another definition in section 3. What is the status of an ongoing project? So, if a project is over and a completion certificate has already been given, then such a project will not come within the net of section 3 or RERA. So, therefore, if at all there is going to be any dispute between the promoters and the home buyers, it has to be sorted out only, or it has to be decided only by the civil courts or consumer forum. They have now included a word ongoing projects. For example, the proviso to section 3.1 says, provided that projects that are ongoing on the date of commencement of this act and for which the completion certificate has not been issued, the promoter shall make an application to the authority for registration of the said project within a period of 3 months from the date of commencement of this act. So therefore, an ongoing project, the promoter has to make an application within 3 months. But what is an ongoing project has not been defined at all. In Chennai, strangely, what they did was, if an application for a completion certificate has been made and the structures are complete, that means only this, just the structures, then you will not come within the definition of ongoing project. That was that huge loophole there, because everyone would just simply apply. They would have finished the columns. They would apply to the CMDA and then say, I am not an ongoing project. But in Haryana, with particular reference to Haryana, it is quite comprehensive. Whereas there, where they say, ongoing project means a project for which a license was issued for the development under the Haryana Development and Regulation of Urban Area Act 1975, on or before 1/5/2017, when the act came into force, and where development works were yet to be completed on the set date, but does not include any project for which after completion of development work, an application under Rule 16 of the Haryana Development and Regulation of Urban Area Rules 1976 or under Subcode 4.10 of the Haryana Building Code 17, as the case may be, is made to the competent authority on or before publication of these rules. So there they have covered it. So unlike Chennai, where it says that if you are just put up the columns and the structure alone, it will cease to be an ongoing project and you can escape registration. So therefore, I think each state has its own rules and we will not really go into that in great depth. Then the next one is, if a person for the purpose of renovation, we spoke about two instances where a project will not fall within the net of section 3. One was if it is less than 500 square meters or 8 apartments. Next one was a project which has already been completed for which a completion certificate has been issued. The third one is the renovation or repair or redevelopment of an old building which does not involve marketing, advertising, selling or new allotment of any apartments, plot or building as the case may be under the real estate. Let us now assume that there is an old residential complex built in the 1980s where 8 flats are there. These owners decide to get together, demolish it, get a plan and put up new flats for their own use. It is not meant for marketing or sale. So such a project will also be exempted. It will not. It is not required to be registered under Section 3. Then, Section 4 stipulates an application for registration of real estate projects. It says that the promoter shall make an application for registration of the project, accompanied by fee. It's essentially a procedural section, but he has to also produce all the documents of title, etc., his plan, architect's certificate, etc., etc. And then he has to give a declaration. See, this is very important, that 70% of the amounts realized for the real estate project from the allottees shall be deposited in a separate account to be maintained in a scheduled bank to cover the cost of construction, and the land cost shall be used only for that purpose. So therefore, normally one would find a positive provision which says that 70% must be deposited in a special account, and which can be used only for the construction. Here, strangely, for whatever reason, they only say section 4(1)(d) that he will file a declaration that he will open a separate bank account where 70% of the amount will be deposited. Nevertheless, I think that declaration is also binding and enforceable. But I thought there was a lacuna. It would have been a lot more better and clearer if they had said a positive section which says that 70% must be deposited. But nevertheless, that is how it is. And then registration is granted. That is section 5. Grant of registration, there is one provision which says if within 30 days, the registration should be given and a login ID will be given to the promoter. And the promoter will feed all details about the project. You see, the most important aspect of RERA is its transparency. Just look at the difference. You get into this website, you will have details about the project, of that particular project where you are going to buy it. You will also have details about these other projects, whether he has been disqualified, whether he has been punished under the act. You have the entire history of the builder before you by just getting into the website for which a login ID is given by the RERA to the promoter. And if suppose it is rejected, reasons must be given after hearing the promoter. If you are not inclined to register a particular project for whatever reason, an opportunity must be given to the promoter and then it has to be rejected. What happens if within the time frame neither rejection nor registration takes place? Then what happens is there is a deemed registration and the project is deemed to be registered, and again the access to the website has to be given by RERA. So it is a method where possibly they felt that if there is some element of corruption where the authorities are bureaucratic delay, they placed a fetter on the administrative power of RERA by saying that if you don't clear it within 30 days, there is automatic registration. Then comes section 6. Section 6 is going to be important because of all the details. I'm not going into every detail which is supposed to be given by the promoter. It will be too procedural. Now, all the details are given. One such detail is the date on which he will complete the project and hand over the apartments to the home buyers. Now, an extension to this can be granted under Section 6. Section 6 essentially says that extension shall be granted on an application made by the promoter due to force majeure in such form and on payment of such fee as may be specified by regulations made by the authority. This is the main section. Section 6 main section is only force majeure. Force majeure is defined and it is inclusive. Case of war, flood, drought, fire, cyclone, earthquake, or any other calamity caused by nature. Therefore, they have clearly cited the various instances of force majeure which empowers RERA to grant an extension. Then there is a proviso. If you see the main part of the section, there is no time period at all when it comes to force majeure. I'll just read the section itself so that it will be. The registration granted under 5 may be extended by the authority on an application made by the promoter due to force majeure in such form and on such payment of fee. No upper limit to the period is given. It is left to the discretion of RERA. Proviso reads as follows, strangely, provided that the authority may, in reasonable circumstances, without default on the part of the promoter, based on the facts of each case, and for reasons to be recorded in writing, extend the registration granted to a project for such time as it considers necessary, which shall in aggregate not exceed a period of 1 year. So what they have done is, a promoter can also apply for extension, but the power to grant extension is limited to a period of 1 year, beyond which RERA cannot give. So therefore, strangely, that has been added as a proviso. Proviso is normally an exception to the main provision, but here it is operates in parallel to the force majeure clause, which is section 6. And if you are going to reject the application filed by the promoter, you will have to hear him, give reasons, and then only reject it under the proviso. Now, let us see the latest COVID situation that we are all under. Now, obviously, today, migrant laborers are left. No labor left, and no one today. The fear of this disease is really making us all stay indoors. What happens now under the National Disaster Act? They have used the word, they have now combined disaster means a catastrophe, mishap, calamity, or grave occurrence in any area arising from natural or man-made causes. This is section 2D. Of the Disaster Management Act 2005. Now they have combined the word calamity, the last force majeure clause, other calamity caused by nature, and read with 2D of the Disaster Management Act, they have now given various exemptions and extensions to promoters. So this, I think there are, in each of the states, there have been several circulars which have been going on. Karnataka, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, I'm sure Haryana also must be having such circulars. So therefore, this extension can be unlimited. It is not as though immediately after 3 months they can start work. So it is left to the discretion of the RERA in that particular state to decide and give appropriate extension so that the promoter also is not penalized on account of the very, very peculiar COVID situation that we are having. Then section 7 comes to revocation of registration. Revocation of registration can be done on 3 grounds. It can be done suo moto by RERA, on receipt of a complaint, or on the recommendation of the competent authority. Competent authority meaning the person who said the authority which sanctions the plan. It could be the municipal corporation, metropolitan authority, etc., etc. It will differ from state to state. And again, he has to be given an opportunity. When can it be invoked? This is the source. Rather, on a complaint, suo moto, or on the recommendation, what are the grounds to revoke registration? Grounds are, promoter defaulted in compliance with the provisions of the Act. Promoter has violated any of the terms and conditions of the approval given by the competent authority. Promoter is involved in any kind of unfair practice or irregularities. Promoter indulges in any fraudulent practices. These are the grounds on which RERA can revoke the registration. The consequences of revocation is obvious. That means he cannot continue with the project. He cannot sell or market the project. So therefore, very effective mechanism under the Act to control and regulate the actions of promoters. Unfair trade practice also is defined. Practice of making any statement, whether in writing or by visual representation, which falsely represents that the services are of a particular standard or grade, represents that the promoter has approval of or affiliation which such promoter does not have, makes a false or misleading representation concerning the services, promoter permits the publication of any advertisement or prospectus, whether in any newspaper or otherwise, or services that are not intended to be offered. So these are all the acts of the promoters which will fall within the definition of unfair trade practice, unfair practice. And then again, notice has to be given, and then he has to be heard, and thereafter it has to be cancelled. Now, what happens after cancellation? See, this is the major problem. After all, the promoter may just walk off if he had already made his money. So therefore, under Section 8, there is an obligation cast on RERA for consequent action if a promoter deserts a project, or if his registration is revoked, or the allottees do not want him to continue. Now, Section 8, if you see, the authority may consult the appropriate government to take such actions as it may deem fit. It can consult the state government to find out whether they are interested in taking over, or any state body can take over. The carrying out of the remaining development works by the competent authority, which again I think is pretty far-fetched. But the best thing is by the association of allottees or in any other manner as may be determined by the authority. Normally in practice, what happens is you are, what they do, at least in Chennai, they invite other promoters to come in if they are interested. Or allottees are given a great option to either to continue on their own, to go and engage a promoter of their own. And they are given, and that has to be given because Proviso 2 also says association of allottees will have the right of first refusal for carrying out the remaining development works. So therefore, if the RERA cannot simply thrust what it feels is right, if the association of persons, they want to continue the project on their own, the RERA is bound to accept it. So right of first refusal is given. And then Section 9 and 10 pertain to real estate agents. I will not go into great depth because again, their function is to interact, act as brokers, sell, etc. They also have to register themselves under the RERA so that otherwise they cannot perform the function of a real estate agent. So gone are the days when every one out of three person will come and say, oh, I'm a broker, I'm a real estate agent, I'll help you out. No, those days are gone. He will not have any legal protection if he does real estate broking without getting himself registered under the RERA. Then comes Section 11, which are the functions and duties of the promoter. There are a huge list of do's and don'ts, which I will not go into, which is extremely procedural. But there is one section there, which is very important, one subsection. Section 11.4H states that after the agreement of sale has been entered into, a promoter cannot mortgage or create a charge over such apartment, plot or building. And if the same is done, notwithstanding anything contained in any other law for the time being in force, the same shall not affect the right and interest of the allottee who has agreed to take the apartment, plot, building. Very simple. This literally, it's a non-obstante clause which overturns the law as it prevails today under the Transfer of Property Act. All of us know that under an agreement, no right really flows. It is only an executory right which can be enforced in a court of law. On that day, title does not pass on to the agreement holder and he does not have any other right other than a right to enforce the agreement. Now, while that being so, under RERA, this section brings in, it overrules the general law. It says if an agreement has been entered into by the promoter with one of the allottees and thereafter if he mortgages it with a bank, even if it is a registered mortgage or a mortgage by deposit of title deeds, it doesn't matter. The agreement which is prior in time will prevail. And that is a total, what you call the principles of TP Act as to whether a mortgage will prevail. The law on mortgage, it takes an overturn here. And I thought it was a very important section because most of the promoters, even after entering into agreements with several buyers and taking huge advance, then go and mortgage the property with the bank or a financial institution. Today, all of us are aware some very big players are there. For them, the financial institutions and banks are ready to shower money and they don't also look into it. And they just give the money, then you will have two people fighting. And if he doesn't complete the project, the banks are going to come and invoke SERFASI or any or the Debt Recovery Tribunal Act, and the rights of these home buyers are affected. This, according to me, is a very, very important provision which really protects the interest of allottees and home buyers. Because today, once they have an agreement, so the financial institutions have to be careful. They can't just, you know, lend money without looking into all the details. How are they going to do it? The website. See, look at the transparency. There has been this act, according to me, has been very well thought of. Well, there could be some lacunas, but which will be sorted out in time. But what is important is, there is a very important protection given to an allottee once he enters into an agreement with the promoter. Then, there is yet another provision which says, obligations of promoter regarding section 12, veracity of the advertisement and prospectus, he has to provide what he has assured. If it is going to be either in the form of a brochure or in the form of a booklet or advertisement in a newspaper or advertisement in a electronic media, whatever it is, if he is going to give that assurance, which will also be there in the website of RERA, and if he doesn't do it, he can be punished under the Act, under the penal provisions, to which I will shortly come. Then 13, again, is another very important provision which says that he can't take more than 10% advance without signing an agreement of sale with an allottee. Otherwise, these days, people were duped, 30%, 40% taken even before the agreement is signed, and nothing really comes out of it. So, this provision ensures that the promoter cannot take more than 10% as advance without signing an agreement of sale. And then 14 is, you know, he has to adhere to the sanctioned plans and projects, which is again, I don't want to really go into it because we have some interesting propositions of law coming. Then, obligations, section 15, obligations of a promoter in case of a transfer of a real estate project to a third party. Sometimes a promoter he can't do that. He cannot transfer it to another promoter without 2/3 allottees agreeing to it and with the written approval of RERA. So therefore, this again is a good provision where you feel that if a builder is not in a position to really complete the project and is a person who's genuine and who is not actually taking the allottees for a ride, he can always opt out by bringing in another promoter to whom 2/3 of the allottees consent. And of course, as a supervisory authority, the RERA also has to give its nod. So it's a counter check. And they are, at least the allottees are not left in the lurch. They can still continue with the project with a new promoter. Then transfer of title, section 17. Then 18 is return of amount and compensation both ways. For example, if the allottee delays also, delays payment and the payment doesn't happen before the scheduled date, he is also bound to pay interest. And then rights and duties of allottees is also there, section 19. 19 is important because the general, if you look at the objects of the Act, the general impression that one gets is that it is meant only to protect the allottees. No, that such an impression is incorrect because there are rights and duties which the allottees are also bound to follow. And that is listed under section 19. And if the allottees or some of them default, the promoter can approach RERA or the adjudicating authority constituted under this Act. It is a district judge who will actually decide the quantum of compensation, etc. RERA will only decide major cases. The individual cases between an allottee and a promoter will all go before an adjudicating authority who will be a district judge. Now, section 20 to 30 deal with the establishment of RERA. I am not going into the composition of RERA, number of members, etc., etc. 31 is important. 31 starts as follows. Any aggrieved person filing of complaints, any aggrieved person may file a complaint with the authority or the adjudicating officer for any violation or contravention of the provisions of the Act or rules against any promoter, allottee or real estate agent. Aggrieved person includes association of allottees or any voluntary consumer association registered under any law. In fact, the Bombay High Court relied on this particular section to hold that it is not one-sided and therefore not discriminatory. Article 14 is not violated. So it's a case where all of them can approach. See, this is very important because otherwise, there is a provision which ousts the jurisdiction of civil court. Today, all the three players, promoter, allottee, and real estate agent, can seek their remedy before a specialized forum which deals only with real estate disputes. Unlike the consumer fora, where you have so many other things also flooding the docket. So therefore, this is a very, very effective mechanism, and if implemented properly, will really serve the purpose of regulation of the real estate business. Now, therefore, there are orders of several RERA where they say that the promoters can also approach RERA for any kind of a relief. Now, the other point that one could take is whether a landowner, lender, investor is a promoter under Section 2 is a K of the RERA. Now, there are, for example, a landowner would enter in the normal method of transacting is that my land would be owned by A. A will approach a promoter. Promoter will assure him 35% of the built up area and some cash or cash component. So therefore, what happens is 65% will go to the builder's share and which he is entitled to market. But what happens is at some point of time, he commits a default. He could default in the construction of this 35% built up area also. At times, the landowners also are unreasonable. They cancel the power of attorney and that leads to litigation. So therefore, a landowner can effectively be a complainant also because he is an allottee in terms of that 35%. But if he is going to be unreasonable, he can also be dragged in as a promoter because he has lent his hand to this particular project by giving the land. And therefore, there are some RERA judgments in Tamil Nadu which say that he can be on both sides. Well, if he has performed his part of the contract, and still his built-up share has not been given or his cash component has not been given, then he can always be a allottee. If he is on the erring side and he has not performed his part, a third-party allottee can also bring him to before the RERA. So it's a very interesting position which works both ways. Now, we will now go to the functions of the RERA. Now, if you say take section 35, 31 we saw is a filing of complaints, 32 is an advisory jurisdiction of RERA, which can make recommendations to the appropriate government or competent authority on all the items listed under section 32A to J. Section 33 is an appropriate government while formulating a policy on real estate, make a reference to RERA. The government can make a reference to RERA for its opinion on any policy decision. So therefore, 32 and 33 are advisory in nature. Then you come to 34, which is administrative framing of regulations and for administrative functioning. 34A to H are administrative in nature. So we have now already seen three. 31 is adjudicatory, 32 and 33 are advisory, 34 is administrative, and then 35 is power to call for information and conduct an investigation if they get some information either on complaint or suo motu about the promoter not adhering to the rules and regulations of the Act. They can even issue commissions. They can ask for discovery and production of all powers of CPC for discovery and production of books of account and other documents. summoning and enforcing of attendance of persons, issuing commissions for examination of witnesses or documents, or and any other matter. So therefore, extensive powers to conduct an investigation against a promoter in respect of his project. And then 36 is the power to grant interim orders. 37 pertains to power to issue directions. And then 38, power to impose penalty or interest to contravention of any obligation cast upon promoter and allotment, of course, guided by the principles of natural justice. And then comes 38.3, where issue relates to, they can also pass other orders. And if at all there is an issue, 38.3 is important. This is again a kind of a section which you don't normally find in any enactment, where they say, where any issue, 38.3 is as follows. Any issue relating to agreement, action, omission, practice, or procedure has the effect of appreciable prevention, restriction, distortion of competition in connection with the development of real estate, has effect of market power of monopoly situation being abused and affected interest of allottees, such issue can be referred to the Competition Commission of India. See, the Competition Commission of India under the relevant act has got the powers to go into it and give appropriate remedies. So if the RERA comes to the conclusion that the act of a particular promoter is actually giving him a monopoly position or he's indulging in unfair trade practice, they can refer the matter to the Competition Commission for them to decide whether there has been abuse of market power or monopoly power, etc. So it's a very interesting provision which normally you don't find in any enactment, where one authority constituted under an act refers the matter to another authority for appropriate action for which they have the power under that act. Then comes rectification, section 39, rectification of orders, and then recovery of penalty or compensation. Now let us come to ultimately in India, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. We will get a decree, but we will never be able to execute the decree. Any civil lawyer will vouch for it, and the situation is becoming worse and it is just not going to improve. Here, this is one lacuna in the act according to me. The penalty can be recovered only as arrears of land revenue if the RERA or the adjudicating authority passes an order for penalty or interest. It can be recovered only by as arrears of land revenue, and you need to go through the state machinery for doing it. I don't know how it is going to be efficacious. However, at this point, I would like to point out, I will straight away jump to the powers of the appellate authority. See here, suppose there is a penalty and the promoter goes to the appellate authority and the appellate authority confirms the order of RERA or the adjudicating authority. Strangely there, if you see, just a second, 57 of the Act, every order made by the appellate tribunal under this Act shall be executable by the appellate tribunal as a decree of civil court, and for this purpose, the appellate tribunal shall have all the powers of a civil court. So here it becomes a decree. Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1, the appellate tribunal may transmit any order made by it to a civil court having jurisdiction, and such civil court shall execute the order as if it were a decree made by the court. So the trial court or the first authority, namely the RERA or the adjudicating authority, their orders will be recoverable as land revenue. But if the same thing is taken up on appeal by the judgment debtor or the person against whom this order has been passed, it becomes a decree there, unless it is reversed. So there is a bit of an anomaly there, and I don't know how they are going to sort it out. Possibly an amendment is required. Now let us come to penalties. Now, section 59 to 67 are all penalty provisions, which entails both levy of fine, which are all huge sums, 10% of the project, 5% of the project, and then imprisonment. So therefore, this was one of the grounds raised in the Bombay High Court, where they said that this will be violative of Article 21 of the Constitution of India if you are going to apply it to all earlier projects. So even in Madras, this was raised, but the court, we have not had a judgment still. Actually, it is not so, because it cannot apply to a project which is already completed. But what happens to a project which is midway? Project is started, it has not been completed, it is an ongoing project. He does not complete it. What happens? We are neither here nor there. So therefore, if the project is ultimately registered, though he started it before the enactment of RERA, he will still be liable and we will come within the jurisdiction of RERA if it is an ongoing project and he continues. So one part of it is before the enactment, the other part of the development is after the enactment. That is why that word ongoing project is very, very important. I don't know, each of the states have given their own definitions in the rules. The penalties are also very, very heavy. And if it is implemented properly, I'm sure everyone will fall in line. Now, we will have to, I think it is essentially a gathering of lawyers. And all of us revel when it comes to issues of jurisdiction and interplay between various enactments. And that is where our money also comes. The first 2 years and after the coming into force of a particular act, we challenge the act first. And then after it is upheld, we say that this court will not have jurisdiction in these kind of cases. So the jurisdictional issue is a lawyer's dream always. Now let me come to certain issues pertaining to the jurisdiction of various courts when it comes to issues pertaining to real estate disputes. Originally, as I told you, it was the civil courts which were exercising total jurisdiction. Then came a concurrent jurisdiction in 1986. The Consumer Protection Act was enacted, and under the Consumer Protection Act, it was optional. One can go either to the civil court or they can go to the consumer court. So most of them in those days, I remember, I was also 3 years old at the bar. Oh, we thought every problem under the sun as far as India is concerned will get sorted out. Civil courts will not hereafter function at all. Everything will be decided by the consumer court. Ultimately, we found it was as ineffective as civil courts because of three tiers, an appeal, and then Supreme Court, delay in appointments, etc., etc. But that was optional. So at that point of time, a consumer who is aggrieved by a defect in a good or deficient service could invoke the jurisdiction of a civil court or go to a consumer court. So things never really improved. And another thing that really happened at that point of time was most of these contracts after 1990 had an arbitration clause. So therefore, most of the promoters, developers will file, and at the moment a consumer complaint is filed, they will file an application and they will have a right to appoint the arbitrator. Invariably, because they are in a position of the allottees, home buyers will sign the contract. They have no, normally they don't even look into the contract before they sign a contract because they want to own a home and they are blind to everything. What happens if there is an arbitration clause? They will file an application under Section 34 of the old Act at that point of time, between 86 and 96. Which seeks for a stay of the judicial proceedings before which a case has been filed. The stay under the old Act was only optional, discretion of the court, unlike Section 8 of the Arbitration and Conciliation Act, which says it is mandatory. The matters, there are five judgments, which you can make a note of on this. The first judgment is Fair Air Engineers Private Limited versus N.K. Modi, AR 1997, Supreme Court, page 533, which says, under the old act, it is only discretionary. Stay need not be given. Once a person comes to the consumer court, he is entitled to continue with the case. The next case was 2005 SEC 294, Skypack Couriers Limited versus Tata Chemicals. More or less, they came to the very same conclusion. Then came 2012 2SEC 506, that is National Seeds Corporation Limited versus Madhusudan Reddy and another. Thereafter, 2016 8SEC 788, Vimal Kishore Shah and others versus J.S. Dinesh Shah. And there's one other judgment, 2011 10SEC 316. Trans-Mediterranean Airways versus Universal Exports. All these judgments say that in spite of an arbitration clause, consumer forum can proceed. That is even under Section 8. These are the judgments that lay down the position. So this is an interplay between the Consumer Protection Act and an arbitration clause. Then we will come to the interplay between RERA. Today, I don't think anyone can say, please look at section 7, section 79 of the RERA. Bar of jurisdiction. No civil court shall have jurisdiction to entertain any suit or proceeding in respect of any matter which the authority or the adjudicating officer or the appellate tribunal is empowered by or under this act to determine, and no injunction shall be granted by any court or other authority in respect of any action taken or to be taken in pursuance of any power conferred by or under this act. This is in pari materia with the provision in Surface Act, 34 of the Surface Act. Now, what does it say? It says, very simply, sitter, whatever jurisdiction that RERA or the appellate authority can exercise in respect of dispute under real estate, civil court cannot entertain a suit. So there is a clear bar. But if it is going to be an issue regarding title, civil courts cannot be stripped of their jurisdiction. You know section 9 of the CPC, which says unless and until, in express words or in implied terms, the jurisdiction of the civil court is ousted by any enactment, civil courts will have jurisdiction, and the courts also always lean in favor of civil courts. But here, this is quite comprehensive because every kind of a relief that can be granted by a civil court, except a declaration in respect of a title, can be given by RERA. So therefore, civil court's jurisdiction specifically goes. Then comes yet another interesting provision. What happens between consumer court and the RERA is the both of them continue to exist. That is the most interesting thing. One second. You can take section 89 and section 3 of the Consumer Protection Act reads as follows. Act not in derogation of any other law. The provisions of this act shall be in addition to or not in derogation of the provisions of any other law for the time being in force. So therefore, Consumer Protection Act does not say that it has exclusive jurisdiction. If you now go to section 88 of the RERA, which says provisions of this act shall be in addition to and not in derogation of the provisions of any other law for the time being in force. So therefore, they also allow the consumer courts. There is no bar under RERA for any proceeding under the consumer court. This is also explicitly recognized in this provision. One second. Where they say if a person was already invoked the jurisdiction of the Consumer Protection Court and the matter is pending. If he wants to now shift over to RERA, if he finds that RERA is more beneficial, he can, with the permission of the Consumer Court, get his matter to RERA. That is section... I'll just give you the section. Now, then we go to yet another interesting provision, Justice, which is the interplay between. So, therefore, today, civil court's jurisdiction is ousted. Consumer courts continue to have jurisdiction if a person wants to invoke the consumer jurisdiction. RERA can also exercise parallelly the very same power. That can be done. Then comes, what is the interplay between IBC and RERA? Now, this is a very important aspect, which has been extensively considered by the Supreme Court in Pioneer case. Now, the legislature amended Section 5(8) in 2018, I think, to include home buyers as financial creditors. This was challenged and was ultimately upheld by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court says that home buyers, and then what happens? Some of them said that they can't invoke both IBC as well as RERA. Supreme Court said it is optional. They can either go before IBC will prevail. Because another interesting thing is, before I get into it, I'll please see section 89 of the RERA. The provisions of this act shall have effect, notwithstanding anything inconsistent therewith contained in any other law for the time being in force. So, therefore, 89 gives a overriding effect to RERA or the institutions created under RERA, primacy to this. We have a very similar provision in the 238 of the IBC, which also confers similar exclusivity to the tribunal created under IBC. But therefore, what Supreme Court holds is, there are two clauses. The clause 238 was introduced, was brought into force after 89 of the RERA. So therefore, it is later in time. So you'll have to presume that the legislature was aware of section 89, and therefore IBC will definitely prevail over RERA if there is an inconsistency, or if there is going to be a conflict, IBC will prevail and not RERA. But at the same time, the arguments that were made was that they can't invoke both. Supreme Court said no, it is optional. A person can either go to the consumer court or go to the IBC by filing a petition under section 7 or come before RERA. But once a person goes to the IBC and gets the petition admitted, then the provisions of IBC will prevail. Moratorium, etc., etc., liquidation. The home buyer has to only participate in the waterfall mechanism constituted under the IBC, and the proceedings under RERA will lose its teeth. So this is what Pioneer says. It's a very interesting judgment. And there is also yet another judgment of Justice Arun Mishra, which is where they deal with the provisions of RERA. So these are the two Supreme Court judgments as of now which deal with RERA. But Arun Mishra merely says, gives the various sections and says what can be done or what cannot be done. No law actually declared. So therefore, I think I have run out of time, already exceeded 45 minutes. So I can.
That doesn't
leave.
Matter. I was just thinking loud within my mind that it's such a vast topic, but still, even though we are moving hurriedly, yet every important aspect has been dealt with, and the judgments which are actually have been touched with the RERA, IBC, because these few questions actually bother the mind of a lawyer as such, whether once there are two provisions, whether the special act or a subsequent act will prevail. Second issue arises is whether doctrine of election would come into being, or they can, you can take a multi-pronged litigation process, that is consumer protection plus the RERA. So we'll all be taking these questions. If you want to, we can do that. We will take the question. That's not the issue. We can take less questions, but at least the topic should be complete according to me.
No, I think fundamentally I have covered. See, I have, I have prepared a very detailed note, but I was not in a position to circulate it. I will do it once the lockdown.
It's not an issue. You can WhatsApp to me. I will circulate it in the WhatsApp group.
Please circulate it, because I'll be happy. Because we have prepared very great detailed orders of RERA also. But they won't, this time won't be enough. So they can shoot questions. That would be.
Or you can ask your associate to post it on the chat box if he's in the group. If he's participating. If he's hearing me, he can post it in the group itself, and I will also take it on the WhatsApp.
Chatrat, I've made some corrections and all that. I'll make it complete.
So we can circulate it tomorrow. It's not an issue.
I'll circulate it definitely, so that they will have the benefit of the entire note that I have prepared. Okay.
So we take the question answers.
Yes.
Right, sir. So the first question before I take the question itself, one was posted, is that again of doctrine of election, as to whether once you have started proceedings against the builder before the consumer protection, can we take before the RERA also or not?
Yes, there is this. Let me just trace out that section. Just a second. There is a section itself which says in the proviso that they can apply 50. Proviso very clearly says that they can go there. I'll get you this section. Just a second.
What? Section 89.
89. Ah, yes. No, not 89. It's not 89. There's this. Just a second. Not 89. Just a second. There is no bar. I mean, the question of doctrine of election abandoned.
79, sir. 79. Bar of jurisdiction. This is one that
bar of civil court. No. There is a separate section. Just a second.
Why go to section 71?
That is an adjudicating officer. Where I told you, for the RERA goes into basically projects and what are all, whether the registration should be cancelled. For deciding what the compensation is, an adjudicating officer will be appointed, who is a district judge, who will decide all those disputes as to what the compensation is that is payable.
I will call you
up. I'll get you the section. Yeah, before we. There's a proviso in one of the main sections which gives the power for the person to approach, with the permission of the consumer court, they can go before the RERA.
But meanwhile, we can take the second question. I'll
get that before we leave.
I will also take it.
You go to the second section. Second question. It is there. It is dealt with in Pioneer. There, this particular section is
section 71 only. People are writing on the chat box. I can also read 31.
31. Yeah.
Yes, it says that provided yeah. that any person whose complaint in respect of matters covered under section 12, 14, 18.
Yes. Correct. Proviso 271(1). So this is one ground on which Supreme Court says you have that option. That is why we are saying that it is concurrent. The legislature itself recognizes YD proviso to 71(1) that you can always opt to come to the other forum. So this is actually another provision which is, according to me, a very new kind of original thinking has gone into it. You see, rather than leaving those people in the lurch before the consumer court to languish for another 10 years, they have given that option. There are at least for the present, things are going to be, things will be moving fast. So it's a very wonderful proviso that they have had it. And so far, to the best of my knowledge, subject to correction, I have never seen such a provision in any other enactment. It, according to me, is a very good. The Supreme Court specifically refers to it in the Pioneer Urban Land case. Yeah, next question.
This is by that person has not a posted name. I would request the participants, invariably they should have log in with the name. That becomes easy. So if insolvency proceedings commence with the moratorium, affect the RERA proceedings?
Yes, because it is another proceeding. So therefore, that is what Supreme Court says, that ultimately, if there is going to be a conflict, the IBC will prevail. So therefore, the provision of moratorium will prevail over any other proceeding, and it has to come to an end. So therefore, that's the problem. You see, today, as lawyers, we always abuse. We think of course, it is our part of our duty to help our client. What they do, at least in Chennai, if there is going to be a very tricky hearing in RERA, they go to the IBC before the NCLT, invoke the court, and then try to get an order there, and immediately try to settle. The moment this is stayed, they try to settle it there. Or their own person comes in as a resolution applicant in the NCLT and they take over the project. Effectively bypassing, but it can't be done at a very big level. But medium level players do it. They take advantage of the IBC provisions, allow it to go for resolution process, then through one of their binamis, they come in, take over the project. Say substantial part of the debt also goes, because it is hardly money would be there only to settle the financial creditors. So there is a problem, but it will be affected. So Pioneer again is the case law for it.
Krishnan, Shivakrishnan, his question is whether the Competition Commission of India has suo motu powers. Sometimes the questions are so many.
What he means possibly says is whether...
Whether Competitive Commission of India has suo motu powers against RERA. It should have been can take action against RERA, I suppose.
How can they take action against RERA? I'm not able to understand the question. RERA is a court by itself. There's something wrong.
Kindly clarify the repost the question. Are there two types of complaints? This is by Vikashil Sharma and seconded by one more participant. There are two types of complaints in form M and N under the RERA Act. There is still some confusion. Why not single form complaint be available to avoid confusions?
So one is for actual compensation. When you work out a petition for compensation or interest, there is one form. The other form is for the general dispute. For example, you see, in my appearances before RERA, what I found was the disputes between the promoter per se and an entire set of allottees. For example, delay, total delay, non-completion of the project. Then such matters go before the RERA. Whereas individual claims, for example, even in a project which has been delayed, they can possibly go and take over the project and give it to the association itself. But that does not ultimately help them get the compensation or interest. So independently, the individuals can also move the adjudicating authority for compensation or interest. So therefore, the jurisdiction of RERA is invariably the for, you know, deciding major issues like this. We're going to go, if RERA again is going to be burdened with, you know, individual cases of interest, etc., this will meet the very same fate that one meets in the civil court or in the consumer court. So that is why those two forms. But anyway, it is procedural that can always be changed. It's not of any great legal significance.
Sir, Raj's question is not as such, but he says that, could you suggest any good legal reference books for RERA, which will help the lawyers to understand the same?
According to me, the most challenging phase, there is one book in Madras, the Real Estate Regulation and Development Act 2016 by one Ravi Subramaniam. It is CTC Publications Private Limited. CTC Publications Private Limited. I can even give the...
So we can have the screenshot of that. We will post it on the group itself.
Can I show it to you like this?
No, sir. We will have a screenshot. You can share it on the WhatsApp group. I will share it.
Okay, fine. Because this I found, see, there are, what is more interesting is there are frequently asked questions which has been dealt with in this book. See, after all, legal propositions, it is too early. We have only, there is one other proposition which I missed to tell you. What is the position of an industrial project, whether it will come within the purview of RERA? If you see the definition, nowhere does an industry being used. It is either building, apartment, or plot with. So the word building, whether it would include industrial. If you also see the objects, it is a very difficult question. The Madras RERA has taken the view that the object of the act is to include every kind of a building. And therefore, even industrial projects will come within RERA. Whereas there is absolutely no hint in any of the provisions of this act to show that industrial buildings are also included. I think one other, Bombay or Maharashtra, has taken the view that it will not apply to, just a second, let me see whether I can get you the, Madras, Maharashtra RERA in Techno Drive Engineer Private Limited versus Renaissance Indus Infra Private Limited. This is a matter where they say, no, industries will not come within, industrial projects will not come within RERA. Whereas in Tamil Nadu, they have taken a different view in the judgment. It was argued by Anirudh. They held against him, saying that it will come. The whole act, you'll have to look at the act as a whole. And if you are going to exclude industrial projects, they can't be creating another forum for it. And therefore, it has to come within the purview. But if you see the act, nowhere does the word industry come. It only speaks of building, flats, apartments, plot, etc. But the word industry, even the objects of the act, really do not cover industries. But it's a very interesting question. Ultimately, it's a question of how the courts are going to view this. If you see, the definition of real estate project means the development of a building or a building consisting of apartments, or converting an existing building or part thereof into apartments, or the development of lands into plots or apartments, as the case may be, for the purpose of selling all or some of the said apartments or plots or buildings, as the case may be. Nowhere is there any hint in any of the definitions to bring in an industrial project within the scope of RERA. But personally, I feel it should also be included, because I think that's a fair way of looking at it. Because otherwise, none of the definitions even cover building.
In fact, just a second.
Building definition is important. Includes any structure or erection or part of a structure or erection which is intended to be used for residential, commercial, or for the purpose of business, occupation, profession, or trade or for any other related purposes. Nowhere do they say that industry comes. Even that related purposes has to be read justem generis with the earlier classes of business, occupation, profession or trade. So therefore, this was the point that was put across in Madras. But Maharashtra accepted it. Madras has said that it will come. It's a very interesting question. Like that, all that is part of my detailed notes. I think within 45 minutes, I couldn't have covered everything. Anyway, it's I thought I should bring it to the notice of our friends that such an issue is likely to ultimately be decided by at least some of the high courts. Not far off. That day is not very far off.
So if a builder has been slow and running behind the time, even before March 2020, that is the day when the lockdown came, can he still get the benefits of force majeure? And sir, can we claim compensation on account of the delay in delivery for the apartments?
Yeah, you can claim compensation for the delay prior to the COVID period. Definitely, yes. That will not save them. The COVID period, the extension will be equivalent to the time that is taken away by COVID. So that is all can be saved. But otherwise, he is liable for any delay which has occurred earlier.
Okay. So, Krishnan Sivaraman, what is the remedy to buyers if project permission is revoked by competent authority? What is the guarantee for the advance money already stood paid?
Come again, the question is...
What is the remedy to buyers if project permission is revoked by the competent authorities? What is the guarantee for the advanced money paid by the consumer?
That is why I read section 8. You see, the registration in respect of a particular promoter can be revoked. But under 8 of the Act, 7 is revocation. 8, it says what is it that the RERA should do after revocation. That promoter goes. But it can be continued by some other promoter. He will get the flat. But for any remedy against the builder, he can always go for compensation before RERA, even if his registration is revoked. And heavy fines can be levied by RERA on the builder. But the individual can also move the adjudicating authority for compensation, for interest.
So one of the question would be like in section 43 sub clause 5, 43 sub clause 5, where we have to challenge an order by deposit of the minimum fees. If we recollect that under the Securitization Act, there was a prerequisite that the amount of money should be deposited as well as under the DRT Act. Then they said that the mandate of having a prerequisite deposit to such a large extent can be damaging. What is your take on this part?
See, that is clear, straight case of borrower. And therefore, it is they said that ultimately the banks were not able to recover. And they have put that mandatory deposit clause. Here, I think possibly it will at some point of time come into play.
On the face of it, draconian.
May not be draconian. But a loan is different from a contract not being executed. So you will be getting more or less a decree. You will get your money, but it has to be possibly. Well, it could come if whatever provisions that are there are not effective. This can happen. But the problem is, see, look at it practically. Most of the builders. Many of them siphon off money and they are not going to have any money. They will happily allow the company to be wound up into liquidation proceedings at some point of time. One of his friendly creditors will file a case in the NCLT and it will all go and that's it. So for effectively, whatever may be the law, people should be careful. They should be prudent. This act to some extent brings in transparency. At least you can find out about the builder. What are all his other projects? What are his success rate? And to that extent, if you are going to be foolish, no one can save you. And that is very in any sphere of law in India, that is the case. buyer beware, caveat emptor, that I think is very, very important. You have to be careful. A person who wants to cheat will get away. He's not going to be bothered about the fines or the imprisonment. But genuine people are people who have substantial assets. They will follow the rules. Because they would like to lose what they have in their official name.
Albert De Costa, can directors be made parties to a suit under Consumer Protection Act, as in the case of RERA? It's the question in the reverse. He is asking in the consumer whether you can array that person as a respondent or not by name.
The director normally is not personally liable, whether it is unless and until he has given a guarantee, or even a criminal proceeding. Yes, he, as a person responsible, he can be brought in, because a corporate cannot be ultimately punished. But otherwise, which law says that the director will be responsible in a civil proceeding? They can't.
Bharat Sharma, procurement of occupancy certificate by the builder, even before completion of project, can buyer of flat still get compensation from under the RERA?
Why not? Compensation is independent. Suppose he doesn't complete at all. Even then, you are entitled to compensation for whatever delay that has happened at the time when you go to court or when you go time when you go to RERA. Nothing wrong in that. The completion of the project has got nothing to do with that.
Sir, Advocate Ravi Inder Singh, he is practicing out here on, in Chandigarh only. What is the status of the project which is ongoing and partial completion certificate has been given by the authority and builder is not registered under RERA? Is the registration compulsory in this situation? And if there is a default, is the complaint maintainable under RERA?
What does he mean by partial completion certificate? Partial completion certificate means a project in two phases, is it? That is possible. If suppose phase one is complete, that will not come within RERA. Phase two is going on, they have to register it. So I'm not able to understand
I will unmute Ravi, or I will ask him to pose the question, reframe the question. And second question by Ravi itself is, can we apply the provisions of arrest under Order 21 as it is a decree of civil decree of a civil court in terms of Section 35 of the Act?
Yes, obviously. That's why it says the deeming provision, that as though it were a decree. Whatever you are entitled to do under CPC in respect of a decree amount, you can do it.
I will just check. That's true. But I think we have taken a lot of questions. Ravin, I will ask Professor Sudipta, she's from the Symbosis Law, to unmute herself. So, on behalf of the questions, I don't think, or we can ask last question if. So, what is the Sudipta? Sumit Jha, what is the remedy if I'm not getting the compensation amount as ordered by RERA?
The remedy is, yes, if it stops with RERA, I pointed out that there is a anomaly there. An order of RERA has to be enforced as land revenue, which is a very, 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 very tough process. It doesn't make sense at all. But whereas, if an order is passed against a promoter asking him to pay compensation and he goes on appeal and loses, then it becomes a decree. So it's an obvious anomaly in the Act which has to be sorted out. But if he doesn't file an appeal, then you'll have to go recover it only as a land revenue. So this is something that has to be ultimately pointed out to possibly the committee which is in charge of amendments. So it doesn't make sense.
So it was a very engaging session, and I don't think that we can get a better perspective of an act which is quite extensive, exhaustive, and that too during a lockdown time when we are talking of COVID-19, when we all feel that though we are locked down in our houses and rooms and the offices also, like you shared before this session, that you had certain difficulties as to how you will be able to log in, but that shows your willpower to join. You said Anirudh is in Bangalore, but be that as it may, it's a words fall short. The way you have explained it, I can't think that there could be a more lucid manner. I will ask and request you that whatever notes you have made you can just post it to me on the WhatsApp. I will share it to them. Because certain judgments, the people who are following under the RERA also, there will be certain judgments, because invariably people have followed those two judgments of the Supreme Court, which are widely discussed and read amongst the lawyers who are doing it. I will ask Professor Sudipta, who are our knowledge partners in this all endeavor of late, those who, they have joined us, to formally propose a vote of thanks, since she represents Symbosis Law Schools in this entire endeavor. Over to you, Professor Sudipta. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And
could you turn on the video, please, since we are live on the Facebook?
You know, the problem is I'm logging okay, every time okay. I'm trying to. So I'm just not going to risk doing that. Krishnan sir, it has been a delight, because you know it was insights into RERA that was the topic, but it was almost like a crash course on RERA. So I thoroughly enjoyed, you know, as an academic, because you went section wise, subsection wise, you joined the dots between RERA and the Consumer Protection Act, and took us to the IBC. I mean, that was fantastic. That was extremely engaging. I also think it's a fantastic topic for such a senior person like you to talk on, because it has suddenly become the bread and butter of so many law firms. Because when I talk to a lot of my law firm partner friends, I hear they are working a lot on Section 6. You know, force measure is the flavor of the day. So, so they're all looking at the contracts and whether there is, you know, a force measure clause in the contract between the allottee and the promoter, or they are, you know, just relying on RERA and Section 6 for remedies. So it's very, very interesting to, you know, hear your perspective. In fact, I was hearing how people even want to bring in the concept of frustration of contract under Section 56 of the Contract Act. Yes. In some extreme cases, you know, and how they are being advised to just hold back for some time. And also, you know, I think in the COVID situation, it's very, very good that we spoke about very time-bound contracts like this, because recently, as recent as April 2020, Singapore came out with the COVID-19 Temporary Measures Act, which has given a whole set of remedies, you know, to several contracts, especially contracts like these, which have time-bound performance clauses, and they have specifically given relief to construction contracts just to decrease litigation. Exactly, you know, what you said, that it is a very litigious area, and we know the India historically how civil suits go. So it was fantastic, sir, to listen to you. I mean, I came out enriched and engaged. This is a brilliant session, not only for young lawyers and advocates who joined today, but everybody who is watching us live. I think it was a fantastic endeavor, both by the team as well as to have you on the panel. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. We are honored to your knowledge partners. Thank you.
Thank you on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and Symbosis Law School Pune that you have given us an engaging session and a good food for thought. Tomorrow, in our endeavor to make another session which should be engaging, again with collaboration with our knowledge partner of Symbosis Law School, we have a session on double jeopardy, scope and ambit of protection by Mr. V. Giri, senior advocate who has been a former judge of the Kerala High Court. Those who want to join us, do stay, join us, connect us. We feel that the session would be quite engaging, so you should join for the knowledge and insights, because double jeopardy has its own play and interplay of the understanding for a lawyer, student, and even for the academician. Thank you, everyone. Stay blessed, stay safe, and thank you, sir, once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Chatra. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.